Gracias for pressing play and welcome to Smart Chickens, a working together smarter diversity meets innovation and growth podcast. On today's episode, we have a very special guest, Morgan J. Ingram. We have an interesting conversation around his background growing up in and around Atlanta, Georgia. We unpack three valuable lessons he learned from winning two state basketball high school championships and dissect the art of sales strategy to help any salesperson to catapult from an SDR through AE to sales guru by thinking differently and honing in on your sales craft. We explore how he uses his creative mindset to develop unique sales plays, somewhat inspired by fictional book recommendations and gaming. We also took a trip with Michael J. Fox, aka Marty, in his Back to the Future DeLorean to get some rearview mirroring insights. As always, this podcast is brought to you by our good friends at digitechie.com, a conversational marketing demand gen and revenue accelerator consultancy, and gypsyforever.com, uniquely handmade wellness products that help you connect your mind, body, and soul to achieve a better balanced you. A little background about Morgan. He's been named back-to-back LinkedIn top sales voice in 2018 and 2019, and named a top 25 sales development thought leader. He sought out sales consultant, podcaster, and a public speaker. Through his journey, he's been able to overcome his fear and step into his calling. Morgan is a sell rep who happens to be a sales coach and trainer that coaches sales teams how to use modern sales techniques that bolster pipeline, leverage social media, schedule net new accounts, and cold call with confidence. He is a host of the podcast and founder and YouTube channel called the SDR Chronicles, with more than 100 videos providing SDRs and sales reps with motivation, advice, and tactics for their sales journey. Currently, he's also been stream living on Saturdays through LinkedIn Live his Muffins with Morgan Q&A. His work has been featured in Forbes, Sales Hacker, the HubSpot blog, and the Harvard Business Review. He has worked at Terminus, an IBM world-class SaaS leader, and began his career in sales there as one of the first five SDRs and moved quickly up to sales development manager in less than 2 years. He's also founded Collegiate Gaming LAN, which he hosted video game tournaments on the Athens College campus, Georgia, with games that included Super Smash Bros., Melee, Mario Kart, League of Legends, and Mortal Kombat. Currently, he's the Director of Sales Execution and Evolution at JBRO's Sales Training on Demand. He works with sales teams and individuals across industries to help them sharpen their sales skills and strategies via their on-demand and sales training program offerings. His motto is, when you commit yourself to be persistent toward your sales goals, you will see the light at the end of the tunnel. Keep dialing. When he's not working away, he loves watching sports, playing video games, watching movies, and reading books. Vamos, let's dive into the show. And without further ado, here's Morgan J. Ingram. Good afternoon, Morgan. Can you hear me?
Can you hear me, bud?
Yes, I can.
Okay, great. So then let me just give you your hype music now, man. I should have had it.
I already see it. I'm already excited.
Sir.
I'm already
fired up. Second, as I mentioned, the ATL. Love it. Atlanta in the house. Morgan J. Ingram.
Murder on the beat, so it's not nice. For this life, I cannot change. In the hills, deep off in the main. In Manila, it's be like candy cane. Drop the top, pop it, let it bang.
All right, let me stop sharing. So, Señor Morgan, how are you?
Good now.
I'm glad. Good, man. Good to see you there. Hopefully you can hear me. I'm testing this all out.
I can hear you. We're good.
You're good? Awesome. So listen, I mean, honored to have you on as one of the first guests on these, it's a pod storm of 30 countdown episodes. Your episode number 26, I have recorded. First and foremost, I mean, you've been named top 50 voices in sales by LinkedIn, 2 years straight, 28, 2019. You're from Atlanta. I can see in your background that you've done your education basically right there, University of Georgia, as well as in Auburn, which there's a bit of an interesting take there too that I'm going to get into. And, you know, you started with someone that I've been following quite a bit, in Terminus, right? You started your sort of your sales career there a bit and worked your way up with less than 2 years. You went from an SDR, one of the first five SDRs on their team, to actually leading their SDR team, right? So, you know, let me just give you a little bit of praise that's due before we get right in. Yeah. So, you know, you're basically a like, you know, there's the a man's man. You're like the salesman's man because you've actually been there and done that, right? So for people that are wanting to start into their careers in sales, especially tech sales, you can actually say you've done, you've walked a mile in their shoes. And I know that now we fast forward from your 2015 days when you started the SDR Chronicles to then working with Terminus. And then most recently as your director of sales execution and evolution with JB Barrows, correct?
That is correct.
That's awesome. So, you know, I want to be able to give you the opportunity to give us some of your specifics around, you know, this podcast is also around diversity and the way diversity has impacted you growing up and has perhaps lent a bit of a lens towards the way that you approach sales strategy and even consulting, right? So, you know, take us back. Tell me how it was growing up in Atlanta or Georgia. I don't know if it's exactly Atlanta. Yeah. And how has that impacted the way you, you know, have you pursued your education and even your career?
So I was born in Norcross, which is about 20 minutes outside of Atlanta. So not born in Atlanta proper. Most people, I just tell them I'm from Atlanta because it's just a lot easier than to telling me, hey, I'm from the city, because most people don't know it. And what I learned is the pursuit of continuously getting better and the willingness to be scrappy. And I got a lot of that just because in Atlanta, it's mostly known for rap. And so when you think about all the successful rappers, they were really scrappy. They dropped tons of mixtapes just to get known. And so I took that same mindset because that's how people's mindset here is in Atlanta is, hey, what do you need to do to get yourself out there? And what can you continuously be learning? You know, my dad, every time I always asked him a question, he'd be like, Google it, go to the library. So that's where I've really done in my entire career. Like if I want to go figure something out, someone has the answer. I'm going to go reach out to them. I'm going to go listen to the podcast. I'm going to go and go to the library. And that's how I grew up. And I always had a chip on my shoulder because I always felt like I never was like number one in the things that I've done. And so I always felt like I had to push myself to get better and to be better at the things that I was doing. And growing up in the area that I did and growing up in the environment that I did, I always had to seek out new information because I knew that if I could be one step ahead, I was going to be better than most.
All right. Yeah, that's great. And I know that, so tell us how you started or unpack how you started SDR Chronicles, because that put you sort of in the map. And to what you're saying, you were seeking knowledge and that curiosity that happened, I believe, probably because of SDR. So SDR Chronicles, unpack that a little bit for us.
Yeah. So I first started off as an SDR. That was my first job out of college, which is a sales development rep, which is prospecting into net new accounts through cold calling, emailing, social, et cetera. And so when I first started, I was trying to figure out like, what the heck should I do, man? Like, I didn't know what I was doing. So I Googled it, right? Because I just told you that's what I did. So I Googled it, YouTube, found a lot of great articles. One article was written by Ralph Barcy, who is a good friend of mine, mentor. And he said, hey, here are the things you need to do to be a great SDR. And he also said, you should start a YouTube channel as an SDR. And so I thought that was interesting. So then I tweeted him and I said, hey, has anyone started a YouTube channel for SDRs? He was like, no, no one's done it. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. So then that's what got me to be like, okay, like I'm going to be the person that leads this. So 4 months later, I was still hadn't started it. And I saw a keynote by Gary Vaynerchuk, Gary V, which most of you have probably seen before. If not, go look him up. Like he's everywhere. Yeah. So the thing is that he was doing a keynote and I felt like he was talking directly to me because he said, hey, if you're a sales rep right now, this was in 2016. So he said, if you're a sales rep right now, you should be building a brand. Like a lot of you guys are probably not going to do it, but you should. And that really hit home with me because I felt like that was a conversation that I needed to hear. So the combination of reading the article, the combination of hearing Gary V, that night I created the YouTube channel called the SDR Chronicles. I went to Fiverr, found the banner, found the profile picture, I got everything. Like, I was good to go. Yeah. And it was really awesome to get all that information from other people. And then I just continued to execute it from there.
Now, that's great. So, you know, I know a little bit in your background, you also have, you know, you played college ball, basketball specifically, right? A little bit college basketball.
So I didn't go and play college basketball. I had an opportunity to go D3, but I did a lot of intramurals. So I played like high school basketball, and I won 2 state championships, which was awesome to be a part of. Yes. And then went to intramurals, and we won a championship there too. So
that's no easy feat. It's no easy feat to win a state championship. I played soccer in high school and in college, nice. And even semi-pro. So I get what you're saying. So the reason I ask is because I find it interesting, and I wanted to ask you, how has basketball shaped your way of thinking in a team environment, which is sales, right? So how has that shaped you in your sales sort of approach in working with a sales team?
Yeah, 3 things. So one is, when I first started playing basketball, I wasn't that good at it at all. And I had to really understand what I needed to do to be successful. So when I first started off, I did a lot of the practice and training. I hit a growth spurt. And what ended up happening is that I was doing really well because I was taller than everyone and I had been practicing. The problem that I had, though, is I got too caught up in me getting taller. So I hit the growth spurt. I was taller than everyone else. I learned all the inside moves. I was averaging, you know, 25 points a game, like in middle school, like, because I was just taller than everyone else, and I had rebounding, I had good responses, and I've been just practicing. And the thing is, I depended my destiny on something else, and I didn't continue to practice the way that I did originally. And that was a big mistake that I made, because my doctor told me I was supposed to be like 6'5", 6'6". So I was like, all right, cool. I'm going to be taller than everyone else. It's fine. And I never grew.
So what's your takeaway from that, that you can kind of turn into, how can I equate this to, you know, someone who's in an SDR role wanting to get into or killing it in SDR role or account executive? Is that sort of
that's a bit of that mindset that you have now? It's where I'm going with it, is that if you are an SDR right now and you're killing it, don't stop. Because you're killing it. Like, start to learn other things, right? Start to learn, okay, like, what does customer success do? Like, what does an AE do, right? You're doing really well, so you don't, like, need to, like, be 100% locked in because you know what to do. Start learning about other things. And that's what I didn't do. Like, I was really great at rebounding. I was really good at my interior defense and offense, and I could do all the things there. However, I never developed the mid-range as good as I could have. I didn't develop the 3-point until later, right? I didn't develop the dribbling until later. But at that point, it was too late because everyone else was practicing those things. I was so locked in on what I was so great at that I didn't practice or look at these other fundamentals if I didn't get this growth spurt, which I did. And so that got me in a laggard position, which I had to redevelop skills, which I'm about to talk about that in a minute. But that's the one thing, is like, don't let other external factors affect your results. And so if you're an AE right now, don't be like, oh, well, my SDR prospect for me. You should be prospecting on your own. Like, control your own destiny. And that's what I wish I would have done back then. But I think everything happens for a reason, which leads into number 2, because I got cut from varsity my freshman and sophomore year. And the thing is, in middle school, I was, you know, top scorer, was getting top rebounds. You know, it was me, like 1 and 2, basically in middle school. I was doing really well. And I realized I didn't get that growth spurt. So, like, I wasn't going to do well. And because I didn't transition to a new role, I didn't have the skills for it. And so I ended up getting lapped, and other people got picked in front of me. And that really made me angry. And instead of me looking at my team to figure out how I could leverage, because I was on JV, leverage them to get better, I got so upset about it that I just was like, every game, I was like, I'm going to drop 40 points and I'm just going to forget everyone else. And that wasn't a good mindset. And so when you get cut from something or you get let go, like, don't be like, oh, like, screw everybody, I'm just going to go solo. It's like, take a step back and leverage the people around you. So after like the 5th game, I realized I need to take a step back. I started leveraging my teammates, knowing their strengths, knowing how I could get them better so that it helped me get better. And then that helped me shine more, right? Because I was so hell-bent on just like dropping that many points per game. And it was all about me instead of it should have been about the team. And so that lesson there, what I learned from basketball is be a leader with other people, whether you're the most skilled or not the most skilled. Because when I got to varsity and I made the cut junior year, you know, I didn't play as much. I was on the team. And then that's when I had to develop again in the off season, every day practicing to get to the senior year, which I ended up starting. And that's when that championship means more to me the senior year than the junior year, to be honest, because that's the year that I developed, I grew. I was a leader on the team. Even though I wasn't the top scorer, I knew my role there, right? But I was part of the starting lineup because I knew how to fit into the roles and I meshed with the team. And then number three thing that I'll add is that you have to be willing to know how to talk to people in the right way and not just projecting on like what you do, right? So I was really great at defense and I got really good at three-pointers, but I couldn't be like, hey, everyone else needs to be good at three-pointers and defense too. I had to leverage my teammates' strengths and I didn't know their weaknesses. And it's the same thing if you're a sales leader. Like, you can't be like, oh, this is how I sell and prospect, so you guys need to do it too. You have to tell them like, hey, these are things that I do and this is how I can be successful based on my formulas, and now you can leverage those formulas with other people. And so, you know, at the end of the day, like, those are things that I really focused on and helped other people with. And those are three things that are for basketball. So, yeah, I've never shared that before. So,
yeah, no, I love that. And that's part of what I like about these, episodes that I'm having. I'm trying to go in a little bit deeper than the surface, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, they say that success happens at the intersection of opportunity, preparation, right? So you kind of delved into that right now with just talking about what you did from your days in basketball from varsity, right? So you were hitting the gym, going to the basketball courts and doing your skills and practicing so you could become that leader, that empathetic leader, as well as that kind of leader by example. When you got into your senior year and you guys won the state championship there in Georgia, Norcross, or was it just the whole state?
It was Greater Atlanta Christian School. So if you guys are watching NBA today, so I played with Malcolm Brogdon, who won Rookie of the Year. So I had to guard him every day in practice. so that was really cool because I told him, you know, and I don't really talk to him as much now. And he was like our top scorer. Like he was getting like 20, 30 a game. My claim to fame is being in the newspaper and getting more points than him one game when we started. So like that's like where I was like, yeah, I score more than Malcolm. But the thing is, like, in practice, I always told him, I was like, hey, look, like, you know, I'm here to make you better as much as you can. Like, I know that you're going to do your own thing and his aspirations are to go to the NBA. But that helped me be a better defender so that I could guard the top players. And also I said, hey, I want you to go as hard as possible. Don't go easy on me. Because, you know, I want to be able to learn as well. And that's key, is like, go find people who are really great at what they do. Be willing to be coached by them, because I learned a lot from Malcolm in basketball. And I now understand why he was so driven. I was in high school, so I wasn't as driven as he was back then. But I understand now why he was so driven. So that experience was really cool. But yeah, Greater Atlanta Christian School, private school. We were well known for basketball, and that's where I played.
That's pretty cool. When you think about that success and, you know, at the success being at the intersection of preparation, meeting, opportunity, tell us a little bit about how your opportunities came about, probably earned, I'm sure, around Terminus and your position there, as well as now currently with JB Burrows. Because I think for someone who's in your shoes, but maybe younger, right, that's getting into sales, they're probably scratching their heads thinking, how can I also, you know, create my own opportunities, or how can I also follow those sort of paths of success that I see Morgan has in 5 years' time, right? So it didn't happen overnight, but
yeah,
can you tell us a little bit about that?
I think it's willing to not do what you're supposed to do. And John says this, is that what we end up doing is that we go to high school, we go to college or uni, we graduate, we take the job that we graduated for based on our major, we spend 20, 30 years doing that job. And then we try to figure out how to retire. And then we go in retirement and we just follow the steps of what we're told to do. And the reason I've been able to see that success in a very rocket ship way, as people would see it, is that I do things that people normally aren't doing. And I'm willing to do those and have confidence in them. So for example, how did I get to Terminus? Well, how I got to Terminus is I got into public speaking. So right after college, I told my parents I was going to public speaking, and I was doing free talks for a while, and I ended up getting paid for those talks. And as I was doing the talks, I realized I wanted to get better because I was, you know, doing all these different type of talks. I was volunteering, talking to different people, and I was so proactive in being the best at being a motivational speaker, which I have a different aspirations now, but you know, 4 or 5 years ago, that's what I wanted to do. And so as I got more gigs, or as I got more engagements, I wanted to figure out how could I increase the dollar amount. So I went to a National Speakers Association, went to a building. There was like 10 people at a round table, and I enter in. So I'm like 23, 24. Everyone is like 50 plus. And so they're like, well, who is this kid? And I was just like, hey, I'm going to get into professional speaking. This is where I want to get into it. So I'm here. I want to learn from you guys. And like, they were like, whoa, they were like blown away that I showed up. And so one of the guys there, his name was Jeff, told me about this company called Terminus. And so what I ended up doing is I did research, and I, my thought process was, well, I could put a resume out there and I probably won't get as many results. And so what I did is I cold called the VP of sales, got that person on the line. She was like, yeah, come in for an interview. And that's how I got the job. So if you're thinking about getting a sales job, it's not just filling out a resume, because everyone else does that. It's treating your sales job like a sales cycle.
That's great. That's great. Great input and advice, especially for those that are recently graduating. So since we were talking a little bit about basketball, and I know it's, you know, you're a big fan as well. You know, we recently saw in June the legendary documentary about Michael Jordan.
Yep.
Right. So Michael Jordan has been known and quoted as, you know, win at no cost. Right. Mm. And Phil Jackson, I think, was quoted in the documentary as saying that he was, you know, it was just his mission to win. That was it. He was just, his addiction was winning, right? So when you think about those kind of philosophies, or unfortunately, we have Kobe Bryant, who just passed away, but another, you know, legend in the sport, he had the Mamba philosophy, which is about being fearless. So when I think about what a salesperson does, I think that they have a combination of both, right? And I wanted to hear your philosophy. So the Mamba philosophy is fearless, and the only thing you're really fearing is yourself, according to Kobe Bryant. And then, you know, the uber competitive, you know, win at all costs from the likes of, you know, a giant in the game like Michael Jordan. So what are your thoughts about both of them? And what's your philosophy in sales?
So I have mine. So rest in peace to Kobe. That day was emotional. Like, I cried on that day. He was a hero that I watched growing up, and I wasn't a Lakers fan, but I just was a Kobe fan every time. And yeah, the Mamba mentality was something that I continuously adopt, because it's hard to be like that consistently. So I continually try to adopt and be like, okay, like, how would I think about this, you know, from a Kobe Mamba mentality standpoint. Then I see Michael Jordan, and it's like the win at all costs, which that is all predicated on your goals, right? Like, some people may not be like that because their goals are different. It's a completely different mindset. And a lot of that has to do with Enneagrams. I don't know if you've ever taken this test, an Enneagram test, and what it is, it tells you what type of type you are based on how you're looking to go after your goals and confidence, et cetera. So I'm a type 3, and Michael Jordan is a type 3 as well. So we have a mentality that we're willing to win at all costs. We're willing to do whatever it takes ethically to be successful, sure, right? Because that's the key. It's not win at all costs and being unethical, because there are people like that, and that's not what we're talking about.
Right.
This is win at all costs ethically. And also, everything I've ever told anyone to do in a piece of content, I've done myself. It's not saying, hey, go try this out and I don't know. It's like, no, like, this is what's happening. So my mentality has always been keep dialing. Now, when people think about that, they think it's only cold calls, and that's not – It can mean that, but like, that's not what I'm talking about. It's to continuously pursue for excellence and greatness, and knowing that you're not perfect.
I like that.
It's making the additional call. It's asking for the additional feedback. It's sending the additional email. It's being like, okay, I'm not doing well right now. Who can I look for help? Where can I look this up? What podcast can I be listening to? What books can I get? Like, that's been my mentality, is that you keep dialing no matter what, because if someone else has done it before, I can do it too. And so that's always been my take. Hey, there's a tons of millionaires in this world. I can do that too. right? There's a ton of people who've been able to close multiple deals. I can do that as well. There are people who've been able to hit quota as a sales development rep. I should be able to do that as well. So I always say you got to keep dialing to hit those goals that if you see them visually, you could definitely do them. It's just going to require another level of mindset. However, we all can obtain that at the end of the day. So that's my mentality when it comes to sales, is that it's to keep dialing. It's doing the extra work. It's doing the things that you're not being asked to do, because that's what's going to make you stand out and get the results you're looking for.
That's great. So if you were to look, I recently heard one of your, so, you know, besides doing the public speaking, besides being a consultant, expert sales training guru at JB Barrows, I know that you also have your LinkedIn Live muffins on Saturdays.
Yes.
So I heard a couple of them. I go in, I go out. I have two boys, a 3 and a 5-year-old. So sometimes, man, that morning I want to hear more, but you know, I hear them, you know, breaking down the door for me to get them breakfast. So, but I heard you say the other day something along the signs around. Listen, you gotta zig where other people zag, and let's say cold calling has not been as effective lately, for obvious reasons, right? That's not to say don't do cold calling as your part of your outreach, but maybe mix it up and add more video, right? Create your own sort of LinkedIn Live or podcast. So a lot of what you say, what I enjoy about your method is that you practice what you preach. So you don't only say it on, you know, on a webinar, and then you're out of sight, out of mind, and aren't actually doing it yourself, right? So that whole practitioner mentality, I think, is super critical for folks that really want to get an edge and be different in whatever field, really, but in sales specifically, because it's so competitive, you do have to have this, you know, what else can I experiment mentality. So that seems to be obviously something not only do you talk about, but you actually do, you practice. Talk us through that. Like how did, for example, LinkedIn Live come to you? Obviously, you've got a huge following. You know, you're obviously well-versed in LinkedIn as a social selling medium, but, you know, if someone who is not at your level, if they wanted to start, what would be sort of here's the top advice for you if you want to start?
Start doing live streams?
Live streams as well as, you know, using the right sort of mix of cold calling, social selling. You know, how do you get this perfect mix, or clearly it's not perfect, but the best type of mix you can when you're trying to get into a prospect, sales flow, right?
Got
so
it.
From your experience, what would you say to folks that are out there?
Yeah. So in terms of mix it all together, like the key things is that you look at phone calls, you look at emails, you look at social, you look at video, right? And this is going to be different for everybody. And, you know, you all can see this in a way that you want to, is that first of all, there's no silver bullet. So that's the first part before I dive into all this, because some of you guys are probably going to take notes and be like, well, this is exactly what I need to do. I'm just giving a suggestion, right? Because I don't know where everyone's at, and I don't know what personas that you target. I don't know what region you're in. So my answers would actually be different for all of you. So take that into consideration. Now let's take a step back. And what I want to address and what I want to talk about is, look at the data of what's going on. So let's say, for example, you're making calls and every 1 out of 400 calls you get a connect. You probably should do less phone calls, right? Let's say you send out emails and your conversion rate is a 0.01. You should probably do less emails. Let's say if your video conversion was 15%, you should make more videos. And so the way to really track this is you need to run a campaign that has, let's say it's 12 steps in 25 days. So do 5 emails, do 5 phone calls, and then do 2 social touches. And maybe one of those emails is like 2 videos in that email, right? Mm-hmm. See what works, right? Ultimately, what this comes down to is A/B and split testing. Everything that I have shared, everything that I have discovered, is because I was willing to go try it out first. I didn't have a playbook or blueprint before I did it. I created the blueprint and then I figured out, does this work? Because if it doesn't, then maybe I need to take out a step. Maybe I need to add a step. So be willing to try out new things, because we're in a completely different market right now and no one has the exact answer. And if they tell you that they do, they don't, because it's changing like every other week. However, there are structures, there are formulas, and there are ways to think about it, which is what I'm suggesting to you all right now. So take different phone calls, emails, social, video points, take those in how you prospect, and then figure out what works and what doesn't based on the data, look at it, and then continuously refine your process.
Yeah, that's great input. And I agree with you. You've got to experiment and A-B test and let the data drive your kind of where you're going to double down. So give us a little bit of your background in terms of, you know, your journey as working for a company that has a diverse workforce like Terminus, right, in Atlanta, and now in a more niche company like JB Borrows, but where your clientele, right, is more diverse. What has been your experience around diversity in the workforce? And to me, that goes deeper than just skin deep, right? So like diversity in terms of thought, in terms of leadership styles. So it's not just, it is, you know, my manager or my direct report, you know, a brown or white or blue or yellow. But what has been your experience with that? Because I find it interesting. Everyone has a different take or different experience, but I want to hear yours out a little bit.
Yeah. So what ends up happening is that as a leader, when you're hiring people, you always look for people that are like you. And it's a subconscious bias that we all have. We always look for that. And so what I see is not a lot of diversity. And I'm glad you brought that up. It's not just a skin color, it's a thought. And you look at, there's stats, I don't know the exact numbers, but there's stats of like, the more diverse your team is with skin and thought, you get more results. If everyone is focused on the same thing, you're not able to see the bigger picture to get more results. So I don't see a lot of diversity in organizations as much as I would like to. However, in some organizations I do, and the ones that have different leaders from different backgrounds and different thoughts and different industries, they do better. They grow faster. The ones that don't, they get caught up because every sales rep sells the same exact way. Every rep prospects the same exact way based on their art style. Because there's a difference, right? The science, I could teach the people the science, like the frameworks. And that's important. Like every organization should have a framework of consistent structure. However, every person is going to deliver that differently, right? Because if you're coming from a different market, then you're going to sell differently. And so the organizations that have the reps that sell the same exact way and they talk the same exact way, you're not going to be able to branch out to the other markets to expand your entire company globally. So it's something that I don't see a lot of. And I think, again, because it's subconscious and most people don't realize that they're having these biases that they throw out in interviews, if they're not checking themselves on that, you're going to have an organization that pretty much everyone's the same and your clients are going to look the same and you're not going to be able to evolve your thought.
Yeah, that's great insight, man. And I'm on the fourth floor, so I'm 45, right? I think you're still getting in your 30s, maybe, or into your 20s.
27.
There you go. So you're 20s going into the third floor. So I'll tell you that I've seen sort of this whole diversity go back and forth in terms of the workforce. And I agree with you 100%. And so does research from Harvard Business Review, Gartner, Deloitte, you know, McKinsey. There's so many research reports out there about diversity in thought, not just color, and diversity around age in different industries. When working in a global workforce environment, you have to have that these days, right? And so I agree with you. It's not, we haven't reached the epitome of that yet, but I think there's been a lot of conscious efforts, in especially because of what's been happening in the last few months here in the US and across the globe about diversity, inclusion, and equity. So I'm glad to hear that, you know, listen, you're gonna be able to keep them honest to a certain degree, right? Because now you're at a consulting, you're getting it from, not being in a company where there has to or not, or there potentially could be a lack thereof diversity, you're seeing it now in your clients. So that's interesting. Mm-hmm. But I'm glad you shared that. Part of this podcast is really to bring the narrative up about that. So I think everyone has a bit of a responsibility, and there's a bit of an origin story that we all have. So I want to kind of go back a little bit to your origin story, right? Your origin line, your background. You know, you're obviously from Georgia. You obviously went to a Christian high school. You played sports. What is it about your origin, do you think, your origin line, that has also helped you be unique in your space and in your craft, which in this case right now is in sales leadership?
I think what helps me stand out in the space of sales coaching and sales training, et cetera, is my willingness to do things that people are hesitant about. And I'm willing just to take that on full force. And I don't see a lot of people that can do that. And really where that comes from is that everything that I've done, like as a kid, I was always trying to figure out ways to stand out and be different. So when I was middle school. So I was selling Pokemon cards. I was selling Pokemon cards back in middle school. Like there was a lot of people doing that. And we created a whole business around it. Like I was just willing to do that. Cause I was like, yeah, let's just do it. Right. Halo 2, that was Xbox. So had a lot of professional gaming stuff that I did there. So again, not a lot of people do that. And so I believe that I'm able to stand out because I'm willing to do things that people might be hesitant in doing and not willing to do. And I've always wanted to be able to figure out ways that I'm doing things differently than everyone else. And I'm always looking to learn what those things are. So I've always had the chip on my shoulder from the beginning because I always felt like I never belonged in the places that I was in. And what I mean, it has nothing to do with race. It's more so just I never felt like I belonged. I always felt like I had a completely different mindset and thought process on things. And it's the reason why I really resonated with Gary V when I found him on YouTube, because everything he was saying is what I was thinking about. And I thought I was crazy because of the way I was thinking about things. Cause you know, back in 2015, 2016, I was like, hey guys, we should start creating brand. And everyone was like, nah, that doesn't make sense. And now you see everyone in the world wants to create a brand, right? Sure. And so now I'm talking about make videos. And now people are like, I don't know about videos. And I guarantee you in 3 to 5 years, you're gonna look back up this podcast episode and everyone's gonna be like, oh, videos would help me. I just know it's gonna happen, right? I'm just looking at the trends. And so I've always been able to be like, all right, this is what I'm gonna do. And I'm very strategic about it. And I'm going to be ahead of the curve by just saying, hey, I'm gonna do this while no one else is. You might be thinking about it, but I'm willing to execute. And that's always been in every single thing that I look at. That's what I've always done.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. So yeah, practitioner mindset is what I see also. That's part of your makeup, right? So, you know, I have some questions around how do you, you know, keep that creativity and that mind set going. So tell us a little bit about the books that you've either read or you're currently reading. Cause I can see that you're a lifelong learner, right?
Yeah.
From your research. And going back to the video, I noticed that in Auburn, you had your own video, you kind of created your own video gaming contest, right? Which yes. Listen, that right there shows that entrepreneurial spirit that sort of like, I'm going to scratch my own itch, that I have this bit of a rebel in me. I'm going to create my own business while I'm at school. I think it was University of Auburn, right?
It was at UGA, but
UGA. And yep. So give us a little bit of insight into that, because I think that kind of goes into what you're saying that makes you a bit different and unique, and what always attracted you to do things differently. How did that come about?
Yeah, I'm just willing to do it. Like, I'm just willing to be like, all right, like, let's see what's going on. A lot of that had to do with, it goes with the question you asked, because you asked about creativity. So I get a lot of my creativity from playing video games. I play a lot of video games. So like RPGs, turn-based strategy, action shooters. And I pay attention to the story and I pay attention to how they develop characters. I pay attention to how people interact. And that's how I take a lot of my creativity to go do certain things. That it's a large part of that. And I will say also as well, I read a lot of books on fiction. So Artemis Fowl, Percy Jackson, Chronicles of Narnia, like you guys have probably heard of these books before. Yeah. I read a lot of fiction books to help me understand the creativity in my brain so I can talk and be more proficient in those things. And also as well, that company I created was hosting video game tournaments on college campuses. So I would go inside of restaurants and bars downtown and pitch them this idea, and it was really successful. And we were profitable. It ended up not going anywhere because we were all college kids running a company. So you know how that goes. But at the end of the day, like, we saw success. Like, people bought in. We hosted think 10 plus tournaments. So we had sponsors that were local breweries. We got Dave and Buster's, if you guys are familiar with that. We had them as a sponsor. I went in there and pitched them on that, the owner, and got funding with was a local Dave and Buster's. So like, these are things that we were doing, and I was 20, 21 years old. And so I just know that, you know, if you're able to do research, you're able to ask for people's feedback, and you're able to like figure out how you can get better, people are willing to help. You know, I had people at Twitch that were giving me advice on how to do this because I just reached out and asked for help. And again, a lot of people just aren't willing to do that. And so that's really where the creativity comes into play, is that I listen to other people and I hear what they're saying, and then I twist it in my own way to make it more engaging and fun and interactive with the people that are around me. And that's what we did with the tournaments. And that was the company that I started. So that was about 8-9 months that I ran that company. But again, if I had to go do that over again, I would learn how to delegate. I wanted to make sure I did every single like task the best way, and I could have done that differently. But that's how I started the gaming company, and that's how like I make sure I stay creative. A lot of video games, a lot of reading creative books.
That's awesome. So you're one of the first guests that have told me, you know, not really a business books per se, which is interesting, and actually it's refreshing, because you typically hear, you know, someone in sales and marketing and or in business talk about, you know, something Seth Godin wrote, or, you know, Play Bigger by Christopher Lockhead, or Niche Down, which, by the way, I'm reading Niche Down right now, which I love. But
I'm all about the business books, right? And I think a lot, and it's funny you said that, because most people know me for just reading a lot of business books. However, you asked about creativity, and that's where I read Friction.
No, I love that. I love that you're able to use both your right brain and your left brain, and you just kind of are letting both hemispheres of our brain consume what gets us more into a creative mindset or a more pragmatic mindset, which could be maybe these business books, right?
Right.
So now this is great. So you kind of, it was a perfect segue, because if you could, you mentioned something about, you know, your younger self. If you could go back in time, right? Get into the, Back to the Future Lamborghini. I don't even know if it was a Lamborghini. Yeah. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, and, I know what you're talking about.
And you would go back in there with Michael J. Fox and go back to your younger self. What advice would you give yourself, you know? And what new insight or inputs would you think about?
I think it's don't overthink it. You know, I think about all the stuff that like I was dealing with from a younger perspective. I overthought a lot of things. Like, I think I could have just been more of a flow like I am right now, and I'm always getting better, but it's really just not overthinking things, because when you don't overthink things, that means that your listening gets better. You're more aware of the situation that you're in. You're not stressing yourself out. So I try not to overthink things that much anymore. I'm very like, all right, okay, this is what we're going to do. And, you know, if it doesn't pan out, then let's make adjustments along the way. So I say, hey, man, just don't overthink things.
That's great. That's great advice. So top three takeaways from this podcast that you would want listeners to take, whether they're going in the journey of, especially if they're going in the journey of SDR to AE to a sales profession, and also in general in life, because I think you're really interesting in your approach to not just the business of sales, but also sort of your life philosophy, it seems like to me. But what would those three takeaways be?
Number one is be willing to do something that makes you stand out, even if it makes you afraid or nervous. That's number one. Number two is, if you are struggling with something, be willing to ask for feedback and help so that you can get to the level that you want to get to. And then three as well, you noticed that there was a lot of mistakes, or I got cut, or like business didn't work out. Like, be willing to take those lessons and continuously evolve on them. Like I always say, hey, you know, you have losses. However, you can turn those losses into lessons, so the next time you're more successful. So that's also what I would say as well.
Man, I love it. I love it. And I think that especially for those, you know, folks behind us that we're trying to lend a hand to, and or, you know, take the elevator down and bring someone up, it's really going to be impactful to hear that from you, Morgan, since you've accomplished so much in just, you know, a short 6-year span of time. We're thrilled to have had you today on this special episode of Smart Chickens, a Diversity Matters podcast for innovation and growth. And, you know, I want to ask you, where can people find more about you,
what are you doing currently that you can have people reach out to you so that they can improve their sales strategy game?
Yeah. So normally I would tell you to follow me on LinkedIn. But at this point my connections are 30K capped. So it's really frustrating because I can't add any more to my connection pool. So if you want to follow me on LinkedIn, you can do that. But I can't accept your connection request. So follow me on Twitter at Morgan J. Ingram. And then also as well, if you're in sales right now and you're looking to level up your game, we have a new on-demand platform at JV Sales. So go check that out too.
That's awesome. Yeah. I saw that on your last, Muffins LinkedIn Live. They can also check you out on LinkedIn Live, which I would suggest on Saturday.
Muffins with Morgan, Saturday, 11 a.m. We're coming back. We took a break on the 4th, but we're coming back with some new stuff. I'm going to try out some new stuff this time, so it'll be fun.
That's awesome. I know you needed to recharge a little bit. You said that on your post as well.
Yeah, I just needed to take a step back, man. And I know a lot of people probably wouldn't be around for the 4th, so I just took a couple of days to take a step back, and it's been really good to come back into the fold here.
Yes, that is true. So you know what? That actually does lead me to one question I had before wrapping up with you, which was, with everything we're all going through globally, right? As a global workforce, as global humanity, whatever you want to call it, what are you doing to chillax or to sort of, you know, have a nice work-life balance, right? So yeah. Give us some tips on that too, because I think that is important for those that are living the moment we're all living.
So I don't believe in work-life balance. Some people say work-life, and it's work-life synergy, right? My thing is
work-life blending. But what's your philosophy on that? Because everyone's got a different
My thing is a flow. Like I focus on flow. So when you think about water, river, bodies of water, right? It's all about a flow, right? Mm-hmm. There's nothing that is conflicting. There's no friction. It's all just a flow, and they know what to do. And that's how life should be. It should be all a flow. There shouldn't be a balance where it's like, all right, well, I agree in cutting things off. But like, for example, it's like, oh, well, yep, 5, I'm not going to do anything. Well, maybe you need to spend an extra hour to do something. Right. So like, I just believe in more of a flow, and each day you should know what your flow is based on what your body tells you, based on what you know you need to accomplish. So I'm more of a flow person, and how I'm able to go in that flow is, I know some days I might have to work 15 hours, some days it might be 6, but I know that's part of my flow. And also as well, how I get away from the day-to-day of what I'm doing. You know, I have to play video games, you know, I'll have like new Netflix shows I might watch like on the weekend, even though I believe in binge growth, not Netflix. You guys probably heard that from me, but on the weekend, like I'll take some time to maybe watch like an episode or two. But during the week, I normally play like video games, and reading. Like those are ways that I unplug.
I love it. Yeah, you're right. Things are a flow, which, because you're talking about flow, let's end this episode with, let's reshare the screens here, and we can listen to and wrap it up with some Travis Scott. Hey, I really appreciate you for doing this. For this life I cannot change. Hit it here, deep off in the main. Eminem, sweet like candy cane. Drop the top.
Best way to end it. I love awesome, it, man. I love it.
It's in the background. I heard it. Listen, I can't say I'm a huge fan of Travis Scott, but you've got me on him now, so I'll listen to him more. I hear that his concerts in Europe are more dope, more crazy, as most things are in Europe. So
that is true. If you are able to
win the lottery or get some huge client in a big, you know, big race from JB Barrows, I'm sure that you'll be getting on the first flight to the next concert whenever a concert is available and we get through this global pandemic. Right?
I'm already ready. I'm just waiting. I'm just waiting so I can hop on.